Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome aboard the Cessna 172 flight. We're flying across France today. As you can see, I'm on the website skyvector.com, and we're going to be flying in southeast France. Bit of a challenging flight because we're going to be landing at a high altitude airfield through the mountains, which is going to require some visual navigation. I wanted to focus today on planning the flight, preparing the aircraft, and becoming familiar with some airmanship philosophy, I think is a good way to say it. We'll get into that in more detail in just a moment. So here's the straight line route. We're flying from Tavaux to Courchevel, and the distance that you can see is 110 nautical miles. So that's a straight line, of course. So if we say that we're going to be flying about 150 nautical miles, because we're going to be going around all the airspace around Geneva and coming through here. I'll show you in detail in just a moment, but that's our basic route. Of course, I've got my charts available for you, and the ground charts. I have an arrival plan, and I've also got a little surprise for you that I found online, which is very useful. So this is our departure. We're going to be taking off eastbound. I forget the runway name. I think it's zero five, making our way down via a few NDBs. So I've generally got a route idea, but I'd like to go into it in a bit more detail with you now first, before we actually get into the aircraft, which is currently waiting outside with the door open. So we're taking off from here, and the first thing we need to be aware of is the high terrain and the fact that we are going to be cruising at quite a high altitude, probably around 7,000 to 8,000, which brings with it particular methods of flying, particularly about leaning the mixture. So the route generally is going to be a mixture of NDBs and VOR radials. Fortunately, in the cockpit we have two VOR needles, primary and secondary, and we will be using those during the flight as intersection points. We'll be using them to help us fly to an intersection. So taking off, going southbound, Geneva's over here, and there are some VORs of note and some NDBs of note which I want to use. The first one is here. I can zoom in for you. This is a very good website. It has the whole world as a VOR chart, and it has different maps as well for different kinds of flying. And of course you can put your flight plan in there. So we've got a VOR here called Chambly Alps Nord. Now I've jotted down this frequency because I'd like to be using that particular VOR. And there's also an NDB over, perhaps it's a bit further down here. Ah, here it is. 346 frequency is Chambéry. And we're going to be using that as our entry point. As you can see, I'll explain entry point in just a moment. You can see the airfield is here. And that really is hidden away in the mountains. Altitude is 6,500 feet. So we need to remember that 6,500 feet, well, 6,600 technically, but 6,500 feet is ground level. It's the highest point on our route. So, by saying that, I mean that all the mountain faces around it are slightly lower because we'll be flying through a ridge, through a valley. So 6,500 is the top. So that's going to be our base, because everything else is below that. That means that we'll be arriving at around 8,000, 8,200, which in reality is going to be up to about 2,000 feet above field elevation. So, let's have a look at the actual idea of flight, how we're going to plan this. There's some airspace over around Geneva. I don't want to fly near that, and also it's got high terrain in it, so that's another reason I don't want to fly in it. So we'll be flying pretty much uncontrolled for the whole route, VFR of course. So we'll be flying, taking off towards the east, northeast, coming down south on quite simply a heading of 180. We can fly directly south. There's not really any visual landmarks, perhaps a road we might make out. I'm unaware of how good Flight Simulator is with the roads in the south of France, so we'll see. But there's nothing too serious right now. We will, however, be overflying an airfield here. So we might, we'll be looking out for an airport below us at some point. Maybe, how many nautical miles would that be? Maybe from 10, perhaps, 10 nautical miles after takeoff. Flying south. Coming around the airspace here. Now there's an NDB to the left, which I want to use, coming down, just to fly past it, which is here, Maison, I expect it's Maison in France, which is 400 frequency. So I'm going to put in 400 as a NDB to our, it will be to our right, to the west, NDB frequency 400. I'm going to tune that in, and quite simply, when the NDB needle is completely to the right, we know that we're, well, pretty much here, which is quite useful to know. And we should find an airport off to our right, and of course below us, so that will help us to navigate where we are on the actual map, because of course in real life this map would be on our knee pad. Now the actual arrival kind of plan is to have an entry point here, because we can fly through here, down this river, and I think there's a train line next to it, take the second right, go down the valley, all visual, and then hopefully find the airport from altitude and come into it. I'll show you the arrival chart in just a moment. There's a little map for that. So what we've got here is an NDB entry point, if you like. I'm using this NDB as an entry point, and that's 346. That's noted. And we're going to fly to that from an intersection of two VORs, and that is this VOR, La Tour du Pin, frequency 115.5, and I'm just jotting these down, 115.5, and this VOR here, 115.4, easy, 115.55. It's good to double check. Now, I basically want to fly to these two intersections, and those radials will be, this is north, and this is orientated north, so this is 180, 190, 200, 210, there's an arrow on that there, 210, and that intersects the 10, 20, 30, 030 radial. So if we can set the 210 and 03 radial from those, that's been jotted down, we will be flying equidistant between the two. How can we get equidistant between those two radials? Let's work this out. We can tune into this NDB on a heading of 180, because it's 180 all the way down pretty much. And when we get perpendicular to this NDB of 332, we will know that we are, or even the VOR, but the VOR will have a radial tuned in. So we'll know that 332 NDB off to our east, off to our left. Once we pass that, we can make a left turn, perhaps 10 degrees, 15 degrees, drifting next to this little mountain ridge, and then at some point we'll pretty much fly in between those two VORs as an intersection. We could make this another way and simply say that what we'd want to do is to follow the 360 radial to Tour du Pin, and then once we become in the centre of this NDB and this 360 radial that we are on, we know that we're there, then we could fly for another maybe 2 or 3 minutes, and then make a left turn, if we can be visual with this airfield, and fly to the right, reset the radial to 030, we know that we'll be somewhat in here. We'll then retune the NDB from 332 upon passing it to 346, and we will fly directly to that on a radial of, so of course that's another way to know where to turn, we intercept the radial NDB of probably, so it'll be this way, so if I keep doing that, it will be 0.9, 100, about 120-ish. So we'll intercept a 120 radial from the 346 NDB to the NDB. But I mean, the signal is coming from the NDB. Okay, that's jotted down. And then from there, it's pretty much not using NDBs, not using VORs. We'll be following the river to the second right, down this valley. Now, altitudes. Very high terrain around us, 16,500 to our left here. But there's an airfield that we can fly over. So I'll be sitting on the left of the aircraft. So when we fly down this valley, I want to be more to the right of it than to the left. So let's say I want to fly to the right of the river, and I'm looking for an airfield which appears to be to the right of that river too. So I'll see the river just if I reach my head to the left and look outside. Once we find that, I'll know that the next ridge to the right, I keep saying ridge, I mean valley, will be where we turn, so after Albertville. And that altitude elevation, the airfield elevation is only 1,000 feet, so I know here that it's not too high, and that this valley is probably not going to get significantly high because there's a river in it. So being at 7,000 feet is a comfortable altitude. So that's the general route. So pretty much nothing is happening after takeoff, it's just a case of taking off, flying south. We'll perhaps start with a heading of about 200, just to get to the left of this line, because that's going to keep us to the side of this heightened terrain here. I also think it's a good idea to first of all tune in the VOR here, Tour du Pin, 115.55, and hope that we can pick up that 360 radial. That will be noted also, 360 from 115.55. That's going to help us. And then once we have the NDB to our left at 90 degrees, we'll reset the NDB to being Chambéry here. There seems to be two with the same name, so we'll say Chambéry 1, Chambéry 2, and we'll fly directly towards that on a radial of 120. So that's looking good. In terms of altitude, anything above 7,000 is comfortable. Now, let's have a look at the little surprise I have, which I found online, freely available. It's the Pilot Operating Handbook for the Cessna 172. So what I'd like you to do is just to get familiar with the figures, with some general figures for the aircraft, to get a general feeling of how far, how high, how quick the aircraft can fly. So you can perhaps pause the video, I'll go through it very quickly. All I'm interested in is, don't go faster than 125. Expect 120 for a cruise at 8,000 feet. We might not be that fast, but it gives us a rough ballpark. And you can see the distance at a percent of power at a particular altitude. Now, our flight is only 150 nautical miles, perhaps a bit less, 140. So, of course, we could easily fly that far. And I'm also going to talk to you about the fuel figures in just a moment. So let's have a look at those figures. And what we're going to do now is go down to the fuel consumption page. So what I'm interested in here is time fuel and distance to climb. This is assuming flaps up, full throttle, standard temperature. We do have standard temperature all the way. I've looked at the weather for our departure and our arrival airfield, and they're pretty much the same. General breeze, less than 10 knots from the southwest, I think it was, which would actually mean that we'll be taking off in the opposite direction that I said, come to think of it. So let's read the notes. We want to add a gallon of fuel for engine start, taxi and allowance. So just remember 1 gallon, because I'm going to add these up. 1 gallon, This is assuming that we're going to lean the mixture above 3,000. I'm going to talk about that when we're actually flying. Every increase to 10 degrees temperature, we don't need to worry about that. And zero wind. We pretty much have zero wind. It's negligible. Now, our weight, I checked in the simulator after having put the correct amount of fuel in, that we are 2,220. So we're pretty much, this table applies to us. So we want to get up to about 6,000 feet initially. So that is going to be climbing at 70 knots. Okay, perhaps a bit faster, but about 500 feet per minute. It's going to take 10 minutes, and we're going to use 2 gallons. So that's 2 gallons for the climb, plus 1 gallon for the taxi. So we're on 3 gallons at the moment. We'll look at another page, the next page, on cruise performance. Now, 2,300 pounds, recommended lean mixture. We'll be doing that. We won't be running it too rich. I'll explain in flight. Pressure altitude will be, let's go for the 6,000 chart first. Power's not going to be full, so we're probably going to be around this area, 2,300 RPM, 2,200 or so. Now, standard temperature, so the centre applies to us. We'll be cruising, as you can see, about 100 knots or so, between 98 and 104. Okay, and we'll be using between 5.7 and 6.2 gallons an hour. Round it to 6 gallons an hour. Our flight is going to be about 150 nautical miles. And it's going to take, we're cruising at about 100 knots. So you can see it's going to take an hour and a half. Let's call it 2 hours to round it up. This is going to be using 6 gallons an hour, plus the 3, we'll add that on from the climb and the taxi fuel. So if we call it 2 hours from 6, of course that's going to be 12 gallons. So we're going to use 12 gallons in just the cruise, plus the 3, 13, 14, 15. Now, a very simple rule of thumb, if you need, first of all, we want to not be landing when we are heavy. So we don't need to put the maximum amount of fuel. We don't need to put 40 gallons or 45 gallons. I'm not sure what the flight simulator one is. We don't need to put 40 odd gallons of fuel because we'll be too heavy for the landing. The airfield where we're landing is high and it's not very long. So I don't want to be too heavy. So if we can find a comfortable amount of fuel, we double the 6 gallons an hour to 12 because we're flying for about 2 hours. Add on the 3 from the climb and taxi, that's going to be 15. We want some reserve fuel, let's just call that another hour of fuel, which would be 6, so that's 21. Let's just call it 20 to keep things simple. And because we're going high into the mountains and it's not very, it's not very reassuring when there's not a lot of airfields around in case of an emergency. So let's just add another 2 hours of flying. So let's basically add another 10 gallons to make it 31. So call it 30, which is exactly how much fuel I've put into the tanks. I've put 15 gallons in each tank. So we have 30 gallons of fuel. So we have almost 4 hours of flying. That's more than enough for our 1.5 hour flight. Well, 2 hour flight. These figures are important to us. That's good. Excellent. Even one thing I wanted to say is even when we do climb up to 8,000 feet with a relatively high power setting, the fuel flow, 6.5, it increases just a tiny bit. So the 30 gallons, I'd be very happy with taking that with me. I've got 2 passengers and some luggage, so we are also within our centre of gravity limits. I think it's about time that we have a look in the flight deck, and from there I'll show you the charts for the 2 airports. Okay, so we just get into the aircraft here, and if you wouldn't mind, I'm just going to turn on the master switch and the beacon, landing light, nav light and strobe light. Okay, good. I think that's all of them. And if you wouldn't mind just going outside to just make sure that all the lights are working. Also just going to drop the flaps. Just make sure all the flaps are not loose as you walk around the aircraft. That would be marvellous. So our clock is working, temperature's correct, and our fuel, as you can see, is being indicated as 15 gallons in each tank. Which is good. Okay, all the lights are working. Excellent. So I'll just turn off the master so we don't waste the battery there. Okay, so we're parked in the over here, in this next to the control tower, just to orientate yourself. The runway's behind us over there somewhere. We'll leave the flaps down for now, not a problem. And we're currently orientated northwest. So let's have a look at the first chart, the ground chart of where we are, the general area, where we're going. So this is the chart. This is the most recent I could find. Courses in French and in English. This is for landing. Unfortunately, it's the only chart I could find, but it still gives us information about the area and the runway itself. Just have a look at the area. But this is more important. The runway 05, which is what I thought it was when I was talking on the VFR chart, and runway 23. I need to recheck the wind. I thought we were going up on 05 because I saw another plane on there, but the wind is 23. But that is flight simulator being a bit strange. So we'll just perhaps pick a runway. We're currently parked near where we can see the control tower. So we are over here at the moment, parked over here. So we'll either be taxiing all the way across here down Alpha to take off on runway 05, or we'll be doing a sort of a 180 turn coming out down to Charlie and taking off here. Either way, the runway is long enough for our departure. This means takeoff distance available, landing distance available, accelerate stop distance available. Beyond the scope of this video, but interesting information. We only need about 1600, we have more than enough. So that's the chart, if you just want to familiarise yourself with that. We're currently parked facing northwest, as I said. This is orientated northwest. So there you go. That is what we're doing. We'll be taking off either way and flying south to intercept the 360 radial to the LTP VOR, which is 115.55. So I think it's about time we get the plane going, actually. Let's shut the door. Okay, get comfortable, pop on your seatbelt, of course, and your headset. We'll bring up the checklist. Now, this goes straight into engine start, unfortunately. So we will just keep that there until we are ready to get to that point. So in the meantime, I need to move the control column out of the way, I'm afraid. Pop on the fuel pump, pop on the masters, the battery, and the avionics button. Can I get that from here? I do apologise. Avionics on. We'll pop on our nav light and beacon, because we're going to turn the engine on. Don't need the taxi light just yet. Now, the radio frequencies, there's no ATIS for this airfield, unfortunately, and I don't want to ruin the video by trying to communicate with the ATC. Maybe the frequency doesn't work. And very unrealistic things. So we'll just assume that it's an uncontrolled airfield and we're just doing what we want. just advising other aircraft of our intentions. Okay, so the first frequency I do want to put in now is the VOR that we'll be intercepting the 360 radial. So I'm going to pop that in there. And that's 115.55. So N1, 115.55.
Mooney, Quebec, Yankee, Mike. Climb and maintain flight level 200. Climb and maintain flight level 200. Mooney, Quebec, Yankee, Mike.
Now the second VOR of the other radial we want to intercept is 115.4. We'll make that active. And that first NDB that we want to go parallel to on the off the 360 radial as we're flying south, we want to fly perpendicular to the NDB of 346. So 346. And that should pick up the NDB as we get nearer to it, of course. Now, we have an autopilot in this aircraft. I would like to use the autopilot for the higher cruise, but only for altitude, not for heading. I would like to control the heading. However, it's good airmanship to be prepared for all eventualities, so I'm going to just line up the heading bug on our heading on our proposed heading of 180 to intercept that 360 radial. Just so that if I need to fiddle around with something or show you something or maybe even have a bite to eat quickly, have a drink, I can take my hands off the control column and the aircraft will continue on the heading. Of course, I'll fine-tune the heading, but basically it's in the right area now on the heading indicator and I don't need to worry about that later. So if I need to use that, it's prepared. It's all about planning ahead. So the altitude, initial altitude, I want to be 5,000. I'll fly to that altitude myself and level off, and then the autopilot can take over. Got a bit carried away there. 5,000 is set. We don't need to worry about vertical speed. We don't need to worry about turning it on or anything. Okay, let's go and turn on the engine now. Mixture on. I have to bring up the 2D cockpit because I can't see anything. I'm sorry. Everything's looking good. Of course, we shout out the window prop clear. I'm just going to press Control E because it's quicker. Open the throttle a quarter inch or so. Parking brake is on, of course. Artificial horizon centralizing. Have a look at our gauges over here. Oil temperature will increase over time. We have normal pressure. And everything's in green. Fuel flow's in green. Everything's looking good. Turn off the fuel pump now. I'll bring up the flaps. If you can just verify that the flap's coming up on your side as well. Excellent. So I'll just one quick check across. Landing taxi light on. We'll set the trim for takeoff. Takeoff trim is set. I think it's ready to go now. Now, I'm going to just quickly cheat because I'm in flight simulator. And get the wind of 237 at 8. So we need to be taking off on in that 23 direction. So we'll be taxiing to our right from here down Charlie. Okay, brakes released. And then we're ready to go.